Good morning, everybody. Somebody told me that Manila is a warm place. So I carried very light clothing. So you can imagine my shock this morning when I walked into this room. but anyway, maybe it's winter season. Anyway, happy to be here. Thank you, Selena, for inviting us. And thank you, everybody who's been involved in putting this event together. My brief is, brief. Just to introduce the program, Making All Voices Count to You. But the more interesting stuff is actually to interact with members of our panel and get to ask them some real questions that will hopefully we'll get some real answers to. So what is Making All Voices Count? We believe that there are very many new developments in innovation and technology that have come about that are helping citizens and their governments to interact like they never have before. Citizens can now raise their voices, and governments have access to new tools and technologies that can help them listen to these citizens and to respond to them effectively. So Making All Voices Count is about seizing this opportunity that has been presented to us. And how do we do this? By finding, funding, and learning from people, from organizations, from individuals, from governments, government associations, from NGOs, from INGOs, anybody who's leveraging the use of technology to help bridge this gap between citizens and their governments. Our consortium of three organizations that run this program. That's HIVOS, which is based in the Netherlands, Mushaidi, which is headquartered in Nairobi, and the Institute of Development Studies, which works out of Brighton in the United Kingdom. And of course, supported by the Department for International Development, the United States Agency for International Development, the Swedish International Development Cooperation Agency, and Omidyar Network. How do we work? The first and... maybe obvious one, like Selena said, is the money, making grants. And this could be to new ideas that haven't been tested yet, that are maybe still information that, still haven't achieved a proof of concept. So we like looking at risky ideas, risky in the sense that, hey, this sounds outlandish, but maybe it could just work. Also supporting ideas that have been tried and tested that need to grow to the next level. So new grants, innovation grants, scaling up, scaling down, scaling out, and so on. And we also try to link our partners with capacity development partners. This could be mentors and fellows to make sure that they have all the skills that they require to make their project successful. So not only limiting our partners to those who already have everything ready to get projects rolling, but if you need a partner, hey, maybe we can connect you with somebody that will help you to implement your project. We also have an inbuilt research component that looks at what works when you're using technology. Some of our projects that we support use mapping technology, and we want to see for people out there who are interested in using maps, for instance, what works? What do you need to have in place to make sure that whatever solution that you're proposing will work in one context, or what will limit it from working in a certain context? We want to understand and make this knowledge available, and that's what we do through our global action, so that everything that we're learning, we're compiling it together, and we're making sure we're getting access to fora that we can share some of this knowledge and hopefully influence policy or practice. And how do we learn? One of the things that makes Making All Voices Count exciting, at least in my opinion, is its integrated learning component. Learning is a key part of what we do every day. And this is both at project level, where we see, for example, the work that JD has been sharing, with Black Sash in South Africa. What works there? How are citizens now able to monitor government services, for instance? How does this happen in other countries? What lessons can we draw, can we pull, can we aggregate that can now influence the work that is being done in other places? But also at a program level, how are funds such as ours structured? Do we do anything that limits the access or the influence that that we have, or the kind of people that we want to target to get funding. Are we deliberate about making these opportunities available to them? Are we limiting these opportunities inadvertently? So learning both at a project and program level, and then now sharing all of this, obviously, on our website, on blogs, at events such as this one, and also our South-to-South Lab, which is one of the things that we hope will be a legacy from the of the program. All these networks of people coming together, working on different program or different problem areas, can we leverage this so that even after this four-year program ends, that this network still exists, that people are still working together, they're still finding solutions to their problems, they're sharing knowledge with each other, they're still excited about their work, and they're having an impact where they are. I've talked about learning, and I just want to share some very briefly some things that we have been gleaning out of our work, which hopefully are very familiar to everyone here, and I'm glad to hear some of this already being mentioned. I mentioned that we are looking at using technology and innovation and leveraging this to help citizens connect with their governments, and we've looked at the contribution of technology to solving problems, and we gave it a number. It's an arbitrary number. It's not a scientific number, but we gave it a number to help us understand how the role that it plays. And that number is 10%. So what is the 90%? We find, and time again, that technology works best when it's put together with other initiatives. I mean, when you take care of your community, if you take care of if you know your audience, did I say that again? You understand how it operates, and you're incorporating your technology in other efforts that are going on around solving a problem. For instance, in Kitui, in Kenya, we have rural women who are using technology that is accessible to them. In their case, it's radio and phone calls, SMS, to put their leaders to account, to make sure they have a say over their budgets in their area. Or in Indonesia, we have projects where citizens are using the mobile phones to play games and to, you know, but not just any kind of game, games that give them access to real-world data about the government budgets in their locality and how these are allocated and what role their citizens have to play in setting government priorities. So lots of work needs to go into making a project successful. Yes, technology is important. Yes, technology plays a big part of it, but there's a whole ecosystem of things that have to come in place to make an initiative really worthwhile. And the second thing I'll talk about is the role of open data. One of the things that we laid a very big emphasis on when we started is making as much data open and make it available to as many people as possible. However, we've noted that even in as much as we've had a lot of success in doing that, generating a lot of data, whether it's in the form of maps, whether it's in the form of charts, of statistics, and so on, it only goes so far in terms of public uptake. The average person, the average citizen, when you get home from work, your first priority is not to think, hey, can I go and look at what data my government has released today about, you know, the number of healthcare workers in, you know, a different province from where I live. You're not necessarily that interested in that kind of information. You're probably more interested in, hey, what can I get for dinner tonight? What are the, you know, what is in my immediate surrounding? What is impacting me here the most? So when we're thinking about open data and the audience, perhaps we've been putting too much an emphasis on a broad sort of audience, and perhaps it's prudent to focus who exactly will be making use of this data. A lot of us here have to make use of open data as part of our jobs. It's what we do. We wouldn't be able to do our jobs effectively without it. But what about the average citizen who doesn't necessarily have to? Maybe the interaction is when they have a particular issue that they want addressed. So we are learning to focus a lot more on the particular audiences that this data is being produced for. there are many questions that we want answered. And I hope by the time the program ends, we'll have answered, or at least started to answer some of them. Some of the questions that we're looking at today, how does mapping, for instance, what influence does this have on of government policy? Are governments responding to open data presented in the form of maps or layered on maps? How does this cross-sector collaboration work? Are people able to work from different sectors and bring their knowledge to the table and have meaningful impact? These are some of the questions that we're exploring, and hopefully as we're sitting with each other, as we're talking, and as we can get at least into answering some of those questions. And I'm glad that we have a wonderful panel representing very many sectors today that will help us tackle some of these questions. So we have a lot of information published on our website. Please have a look. Project program level learning, and I'll be also interested to hearing much more from you and as we interact with the panel later on to hear your questions. So thank you, Selena. I'll stop here for now. Thank you.